My name is David Sankel. I work at Stellar Science, and we're going to talk about CMake and Git. Now, I want to see a show of hands. Who's super excited about CMake and Git? Okay. I see like six of you. All right. What's that? Sure. All right. Now, who's super excited about being able to use any C++ code on the internet seamlessly and be able to incorporate it into your project? How many of you don't care about that? All right. See, that's why I'm talking about this. All right. So I just want to do some recognition. This is not my work. Well, not just my work. These are other people at Stellar Science. Wilda Cherry, John MacGyver, Conrad Pullman, and Kara Walker, who are just awesome guys who were able to develop these things. But what I want to talk about is how to make really awesome code. At the center of the circle of making really awesome code, if your company wants to make awesome code, is to have top developers, right? We know that. But you need to have an infrastructure that supports them so they can make their awesome stuff. And that includes all kinds of neat things. Deployment, continuous integration, code reviews, etc., etc. But today we're just going to be talking about version control and the build system. Okay, so if you see anything up here that you guys are not doing, I highly suggest that you look into this and try to incorporate it into your development system. So, why version control and build systems? Now, let's say a Python developer or a Java developer who's used to Maven decides they want to start using C++ and they see, okay, well, this is a neat language. Now I want to try pulling in this library and that library and be able to start messing around with other people's libraries. What's the reaction when they see how we do things today? What? Like, how can you, this is, what? It's a mess. It's a huge mess if you want to try using third-party code. We've got a problem. We've got a dozen build systems, each of them incompatible with the other. Or, if they're compatible with the other, that makes it even worse most of the time. We got a handful of version control systems. Each person chooses his favorite. And everybody likes to use their own thing differently. End result. High cost to use third-party code. This is a big, big deal. We can't share each other's code. That means we're talking about wheels being reinvented all the time. We're talking about updates from third-party code that aren't propagated to the people who are using it, security updates in a lot of cases. We have old versions of things proliferate. You know, I can't tell you how many times I've seen like super old versions of zlib and things like that all over the place. And as a result, we have buggy code. So I want to introduce a new concept that we don't really talk about very much. And this is the word asocial. It's an adjective, and it means avoiding social interaction, inconsiderate of, or hostile to others. And we usually use this in a context of when you're talking about person-to-person interaction. But we also have source code-to-source code interaction. And currently, I think that we are being very asocial. So just so everybody gets used to this, I want you guys to all say asocial code. All right, 3, 2, 1.
Asocial code.
Okay, so if somebody uses some crazy build system and some crazy version control system, what do you say that is?
Asocial.
There we go. All right, so what is the solution to this? Etiquette. The rules indicating the proper and polite way to behave. Now, it seems like when we talk about this and we see an open source thing and we say, oh, and they use something strange, we say, oh, well, I mean, they're putting the code on the internet. It's up to them. You know, who am I to say what kind of behavior they have? You know, what's the quality of the code that they put out? And I think that that is wrong. Etiquette is based on having a mutual respect of other people. We never say, oh, well, that person, you know, walked out in front of me. It was okay for him to say whatever he wanted as opposed to hello, and instead say something expletive that I won't say on the camera. You know, so I think that we need to start thinking about this. how we can have an etiquette for our code. So when we have to decide what is good etiquette, we're going to have some choices to make, right? And the question comes, how are we going to choose? So we want everybody to have this good etiquette about the things they're going to use and how do they use them. Well, the first thing that I think is a good criteria is we want to take incremental steps from already adopted tools. So I don't think that the answer to these problems is, oh, let's build a new tool and then just hope that everybody adopts it. I think the chances of that actually working are very slim. We want it to work for the majority of situations. There's a comment. So the question was, isn't that what happened with Git? Somebody put out this tool, said everybody use it, and then everybody used it. Sure. I think that happened. But now we're at a different stage, and still not everybody is using Git. So that's where I really think that we have to take incremental steps from already adopted tools. There was Git, but there were like 500 other of these things. Well, not 500, but there were several all that came out at the same time. Which one's going to succeed? You don't know. At this point, we do. But we want to have these things work for the majority of situations. So if we have some users who are in highly secured environments, we have some users who have tiny projects, some users who have gigantic projects, we want our etiquette to be able to work for the majority of the situations. There's always going to be an off one that you're just not going to be able to please. We want engineering superiority. So if there's a choice between doing saying that this is polite or this is polite, we want the superior engineering choice to be the one that, you know, carries it home. But sometimes, you know, none of these really apply, and you just kind of gotta go with something. You know, just like with language, when you see somebody and you say hello, why do they choose hello as opposed to hiya? I don't know. It was kind of an arbitrary choice. But fortunately, I don't think we have a lot of those arbitrary choices that we need to make in this context. So, which version control system is the polite one to use for C++? Darks! No! No!
CVS.
It's a step.
Git is the only viable option. If we're going to all agree on having one thing that's going to work for the majority of people, Git is the only viable option. Now, it's hard for me to say that because I love Mercurial. I think Mercurial is a beautiful interface, works much better for beginners, but it's no longer viable. Where do you get all of this code that you see people putting stuff up at these conferences? How do you download it? GitHub. Most major software these days is in Git, and certainly the vast majority of new software released is in Git.
I'm very curious. Would it be okay if you took a quick show of hands how many people agree with you?
How many people agree with me?
Are we talking about like open source, or are we talking about, I mean, there's a lot of legacy code that there's no business case to move away from in a pre-existing version control system that's working.
First, I just want to repeat the comment. So we did a poll, and the vast majority of people raised their hands that they agree with me. Then there was another comment that said, well, what about these old systems? You know, they have something that works for them. Why not continue using it? I would say, that's fine. They can do that, but it's asocial, right? So if you want to interact with other code bases and other people, then they're just going to be the asocial ones on the block.
Mostly, I'm sure people would disagree with me, subversion, and that was being incrementally improved. So why isn't, so
isn't it a
counterexample that Git came along and blew it away? Shouldn't we still be improving subversion and making that better and using that?
So the comment was that in reply to that comment?
I want to reply to that.
Okay, go ahead.
So I think Git and Mercurial and Brassard, they came up at an interesting time because distributed version control was something new at that time. There may have been distributed systems before, but that was the time when distributed version control became something the general public knew about for the first time. So it filled, and it was so the problem with adopting a new technology is that it has to be so much better than the existing thing that it clears the threshold of the effort of changing. And distributed version control did that.
I sort of agree with you, by the way. I actually played a little bit devil's advocate there.
Okay, so there was a devil advocate comment.
The terms of source code control or revision control, whatever you call it, I mean, it is. I consider the distributed one is actually almost a fundamentally different thing to a centralized system like Zero.
So the discussion pretty much brought out the fact that distributed vision control wasn't an incremental change from SVN, that it had an overwhelmingly special new feature that made it viable.
Yeah. It's worth noting also that Git is 10 years old now, and I think it's only become dominant in the last 2 to 3 years.
I'll comment that Git is 10 years old now, but it's only become dominant in the past 2 or 3 years.
So I also kind of agree with you, but I think this statement is quite problematic because it's never good for anybody if there is only one viable option. Diversity is, I'd say, always good.
So the comment was that it's never good to have only one viable option. Diversity is always good. And I totally agree with that. I do very much not want to see new version control systems being developed or to have that development stop. What I'm talking about is talking about what is the standard for communication today, the etiquette for today.
So I think it's interesting that Mercurial and Git actually have pretty good interoperability by now, because there's the htgit command, where you can just clone a Git repository into a Mercurial repository, and I think Git by now has something equivalent to do the other way around.
So the comment is that at least with Git and Mercurial, there's pretty good interoperability, and I found it to be pretty good except when it isn't, because I've actually tried this a lot, and there were big problems that I ran into eventually.
Of all this talk is it's about open source, and there's a lot of people in the room, or maybe here at C++ now that still in the old, they're in their own company and they don't share code that much, and that's beginning to be more like people have a few projects that are open source, but that's still that old talk is. Really, it's all about just open source projects.
So the comment is a lot of people don't use open source stuff, so it seems like this talk is only about open source. And it's not just about open source. There are also company to company and project to project sharing that goes on quite frequently in the commercial world and the closed source world. And I think this also applies to that.
Yeah, in reply to that, I've heard more than one person at this conference talk about their company's GitHub appliance.
And another reply was saying that there's been a lot of talk about people who have companies and they have their own GitHub appliances. All right, so let's move on. And we already took a poll on this. So, okay, Git's the only viable option, but how do we use it? So how many different ways can you use Git? Does anybody want to shout it out?
Unlimited.
Unlimited. Greater than one, at least, right? So, I'm going to propose a way to lay out your Git stuff that works, and I think works very well if you're working with other repositories. So I'm going to just go ahead and start out and say using submodules. On your server, you have different repositories. One of them is called the all repository. This is the one that has the other submodules in it. Each of these repositories are individual repositories that it refers to. So on your client, when you check out something, you check out all, then you get a copy of repo 1, I'm using copy loosely here, in your subdirectories, and then you can modify everything there. Okay, does that all make sense so far? All right, if something doesn't make sense, please stop me. Please feel free to stop me. Here is how you would add a new submodule to the all project, so you get a new repository stuck in there, and then you add the submodule this way. And for a lot of these commands, feel free to download the slides afterward and look at the manual page to get a really good understanding of what's going on. So, etiquette has rules. The All Super project contains everything for your company or whatever you're doing. Why would we care about that? Why would we want our super project which contains anything or everything? Any ideas? You want to reproduce the build? And why would you want to reproduce the build?
Because if a test fails, then maybe you want to rerun it on a developer machine.
So the comment is that if you have a test that fails, you want to rerun it. And that's pretty much it, is that if you have something which you're modifying, which has a lot of different dependencies on it, you want to make sure that you compile all those dependencies as part of your build to make sure that you didn't break anything as much as possible. All your submodules are hosted on your project's Git server, not in some Git server somewhere else. Now, why would we want that?
Well, the other server could be unavailable, or even worse, someone could do an upstream rebase.
So the comment is that the other server could be unavailable or someone could do an upstream rebase. And yeah, those are good, valid reasons for that.
You already mentioned security and trust is not transitive. So.
The comment was security can be important for some folks and trust is not transitive. That's another really good reason to do it. So that's the rule. And security is handled based on the granularity of repositories as opposed to something else. Now, why would we want that? Because basically in Git, you can't really do security any other way. It's based on a repository. So you can't like hide certain directories in your repository using any normal Git means that I'm aware of. Your submodules do not have their own submodules. So this rule here reflects an anti-pattern where it seems like people like to have their project and then put all their dependencies as submodules of that project. The problem with this is if everybody's doing that, you're going to get replicated versions of a library because each library likes to have its own submodule of the same project. And that just is all kinds of craziness. So you just have your all project and those submodules beneath it, and nothing goes deeper than that. OK. So if you need another super project, which happens a lot, especially if you have security and you only want this person to see these things. You can make other super projects that don't include everything. You can do that on an as-needed basis, but you do have that all one there too. All right. Comment.
I don't quite follow the your model. I don't quite see how if I want to depend on a project and it has submodules, what does my repository look like? I can't add it as a sub-project, as a submodule. Because it itself has submodules?
So the question is, well, what do you do if you depend on a project that does have submodules? So if a project has its own submodules like that, what kind of project is it?
A super project.
It's a social code. So it's necessarily difficult to work with a social code. So that's why we want to put down these rules. Yeah, people are going to be asocial, and it's going to be a pain in the butt. Absolutely.
So if you have three different projects, you still want to stick them all in one super project?
So the comment is if you have three different projects, you still want to stick them all into one super project. And the answer is yes. That would be the all super project. You keep everything in there.
What if you have like 10 small libraries? They are all part of the same super project. But one of these libraries actually depends on only one of the others. Do you still have to get the entire super project? Isn't it more logical to have the required library as a submodule of the library that depends on it?
So the comment was, if you have this really tiny situation to where it's not a big deal, isn't it okay to do this submodules or this the project having a submodule which is its dependencies? And the answer is yes, you can do that, but for reasons stated earlier, that would be asocial. That'd be make it hard for other people to work with your code.
I guess something's already mystified me, and I've never understood what the utility of the super project is or what benefit it gives as opposed to just having your 10 projects each one independent. What, I don't really even see how they're tied together with a super project. What does that actually do?
So the comment is what's the point of having the super project? Because it has all these different sub-projects in it, you might as well not have a super project. And the answer to that is really related to the build system, which we'll get to later. But you could have a script. What's that?
So my mystification is not unjustified.
So your mystification is not justified. So I would say it's somewhat justified. That's a question.
So do sub-projects have the ability to check out a particular commit or tag? So there's good reason why, you know, different projects might be at different versions of the library.
So the comment is, do sub-projects have their own commit or tag? I'm not really sure what you mean.
So when my super project pulls in a sub-project, can it check out a particular commit or tag? Because my super project might not depend or work correctly on the latest version of that sub-project.
Ah, okay, excellent question. So the question, as I understand it now, is if you have the super project, can you have it check out the sub-projects at particular commit points? As opposed to always being on the latest and greatest? And the answer is yes. Yeah, with Git, you can do that.
So is it your contention, is this what you're saying? So if I'm writing a library and I want to be social, I can't depend on another project because it itself might be asocial. Or that would make me asocial to somebody else who wanted to depend on me, rather. So the result is that I should kind of ruthlessly dependency inject everything into my library and
So the comment is, the question is, does that mean that if I depend on something which is asocial, do I have the choice of being asocial myself or like sort of fixing their thing? If you want to be social, you can't depend on anything. In a submodule sense. And it's a tough situation. You know, if you're going on a date with somebody which is very rude, you know, do you come across as rude too? I don't know. That's a philosophical question.
The all project is asocial.
The comment is that the all project is asocial. And I think that the answer to that is yes. The all project is fundamentally asocial. That's something that's for you only. That's not something that you would like put on GitHub. All right. Let's move on.
Why wouldn't you use some kind of dependency manager like CPM or
something? So the question is, why wouldn't you use a dependency manager or something like that as opposed to using submodules? And the answer to that is, everybody raise your hand who's using a dependency manager. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. How many people are not using a dependency manager? A lot more. So I agree that a dependency manager would be great, but I'm talking about for now, right? I hope that a dependency manager can come through that will help with this, because there's manual steps.
So did I understand correctly, you don't expose the all project to the public?
The question is, so you don't expose the all project to the public, and the answer is yes, you do not.
Okay, so why, or will you talk about that later?
So why do you not expose the all project to the public? Because it's not something that people can use unless they're doing the same things that you're doing. So if somebody wants to have their own project, they don't want to add it to your all thing. They have their own all. All right, let's move on. Automatic submodule pointer updates. Now, this is kind of contentious, and we went both ways in our company in terms of whether or not you want to do automatic submodule pointer updates. So here are the two different ways you can do things with this setup. You can go into the submodule, do your commit there, but then the super project is still pointing to an older commit of that submodule. So then you have to go over to your super project, your all project, and then do another commit there, updating the pointer to the latest version of the submodule that you modified. That's one way to do it. But we found that developers find the extra step to be burdensome. And then you have to come up with an extra commit message, and it just seems kind of tedious. So what we do now is we have automatic submodule pointer updates. And what that does is when I update something to this repository, on the server, it automatically updates the super project. So it's just not something that I worry about. That happens on the server side. So how you do this is you add a post-receive hook on the server. So on the server side, you can add these different hooks. This is not something difficult to write, but every time a commit is done to this submodule, it will automatically update the super project on the server. All right. I'm not going into the details of how to do that. Is there a question? Comment?
Just a comment that the post release management interest group talked about just a few hours ago, went through this process. And that's what we're doing now. I mean, essentially, we don't call the super project all, we call it boost. We do automatic commit, and we do that, have the hooks running, and we shut it down periodically just before a release and whatnot. We, the release managers, and one of the things in the discussion came out that these are really the people that are very concerned about quality assurance. They want that automatic commit process to essentially run, make the commit on a clone or something, run the regression tests. If nothing regresses, then go ahead with the automatic commit. But if something regresses, you know, announced somehow by email or whatever, then however you want to do it, that no, we're not going to do this automatic commit until we resolve why it is causing difficulties.
So the comment was is that this is something in active discussion with Boost right now. They do automatic submodule pointer updates as it is right now, but they're talking about moving to something where it'll actually run unit tests or something like that before we'll do the automatic submodule pointer update. And I think that's really interesting. Whether or not you do automatic submodule pointer updates does not really have much effect in terms of the etiquette of your code, right? Because if you share your all, you're not expecting people to use the all to develop with unless they are part of your thing. So, yeah.
How does this super project, submodules play with branching and development branches?
So the question is, how do you deal with branching and that kind of a thing? And I'm going to go into that in a little bit. All right. So let's move forward. So typical usage in this kind of a setup, if you want to check out a repository, this is the super project, you use git clone to wherever your stuff is, you move to that new directory all, and then you run these two submodule commands. This one makes sure that each of your submodule directories are filled in with the good stuff. And the second one checks out the master branch on each submodule. Now some advanced Git users might say, well, I'm not going to check out master unless I'm actually working on it. Yeah, sure, you can do that. But this seems to work for new people pretty well. Oh, and also this git submodule for each command, for those of you who haven't seen this, this just means these first three words is that run what follows inside each submodule. So, you know, you could do an ls over here instead of git checkout master, and it will just list the contents of every submodule. It's really handy to know that. Now, if you want to commit a modification to one of these submodules, you go to the directory, in this case, we're checking out a new branch because if you follow the other good things, and you probably do code reviews, and it's really handy to check out a branch, make your modifications. So this is making a new branch, you make your modifications, use git GUI to commit. Now, a lot of you guys might be console lovers. How many of you guys are console lovers? Yeah, probably half. And I am too. But I do highly recommend using git GUI when you're starting to work with Git, because there are two Git mistakes that every new user makes. The first one is you don't set your email address up properly, and you end up committing under the machine's name. How many of you guys have done that? Oh, okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, 7. And the other one is that you commit on a branch that doesn't have master checked out on. So I think they're called disconnected heads or something like that. But anyway, if you use Git GUI, it'll make it very clear if you make those two mistakes. Once you get used to it, you can go with the command line and you won't hit the mistake. Another nice thing about Git GUI is you get an opportunity to look at the diffs of your code before you commit, so you can do your own review before you commit.
A lot of Windows users would say that instead of saying Git GUI, they would say use Tortoise Git.
And the comment was that for Windows users, instead of using Git GUI, you can use Tortoise Git, and absolutely.
And while we're on the subject, I use Source Tree on my Mac, and there's a Windows version also. I found it a lifesaver myself. I think
Comment was that for Macs and even for Windows 2, Source Tree is another valid option. Very nice.
So it looks like you always work on a branch of your own. So you recommend the Git flow workflow, or?
So the question is, do you recommend the Git flow workflow? I really don't know too much about it. So generally, what I'll do is I'll make a branch, I'll push it onto the server, and then I will email somebody saying, here's my branch, please do a code review of that. If you're using GitHub, then you have a pull request. Yeah. All right. So let's talk about third-party requirements, because I think most people have third-party libraries that they use. But let me just verify that. How many do not use third-party libraries? Nobody. One person. So I got to hear about this. What project do you use that doesn't use any third-party libraries?
Windows. At least up until a certain point, we were banned to rely on any third-party code.
Wow.
Because of the various legal limitations.
So the comment was, and you say you're working on Windows?
Yes.
Okay. Windows itself can't have any third-party stuff.
It was as of 2 years ago. I switched to since then.
Oh. As of 2 years ago. So I'm glad that you're able to use third-party stuff now. That's much better.
I think that's a fairly common requirement in closed source situations.
So the comment is that it's a fairly common requirement in closed source situations. So what I'm seeing here from the room is that it's not common enough for enough people to raise their hand, but I believe that it does exist. Yeah. And this, so if you're in one of those situations, this isn't going to apply to you. You don't have to worry about third-party code. But if you do, here's a nice way to work with it. So I'm calling this bounce patching. I don't know if somebody has already come up with this idea beforehand and named it something else. If they did, let me know, and I will do proper accreditation here. But the way it works is like this. You have a vendor branch, and this is the master branch of your code that you're working with, or whatever is the main branch that they use. And then you say over here on P0, you say, okay, I would like to make a couple of modifications to this library. So you start your master branch right here. You made this commit, you made this commit, you made this commit. So then the thing happens is, well, now we've done some pull requests for all three of these things. They applied the third patch, they applied the first patch, somebody else brought in a fourth patch. So really, only P2 is the only one outstanding. How do I get myself to a happy place again? How do I update? So the way we do this is through a phantom merge. So this M here has two parents, and it's still your master branch. But it's really only in name associated with this P3, because the contents of M is identical to the contents of P4. So what I do is I make that, and then I just apply, I cherry pick my outstanding patch here. So at any single point in time, you can always look at your repository and see how many patches you have applied that are outstanding, that haven't been applied to the vendor's branch. And it looks kind of complicated, but in practice, it's not too bad. There's a question.
So how do we include this third-party library in a submodule?
So the question is, how do we include this third-party library in a submodule? And the answer is yes, in a submodule. So if you have zlib, you have a zlib submodule. It's, of course, your copy of the library. It's not using the one on GitHub. And I'll explain more how that works in a minute too. But just assume you have a way to get your third party on there and you have a way to keep your vendor branch always up to date for now. Okay, so if you want to update the third party repository to the latest, this is the Git sequence of commands you need to do that. And again, if these commands don't make sense to you, I highly recommend just checking out these slides after and going through this. So you go to the third party repository, you check out the vendor branch, and you pull. So that basically puts you up here at P4. You check out dash B phantom merge, so you're making a new branch, but you're still stuck here at P4 on this new phantom merge branch. And then you use this git merge dash s hours command. This dash s means strategy, and hours means keep everything that's on mine and ignore whatever's coming in on the other side of the merge. So that basically says, okay, I'm going to keep this, I'm going to merge with this, but I'm going to ignore everything that comes off of this other branch. That's what gives you this M here. Then you check out master, which switches you back to P3. You merge up to your phantom merge branch, so that moves master up here. And then you delete your phantom merge branch. You only need it temporarily. You cherry pick your patch that's still outstanding, and then you push back onto master. So put this on your internal wiki pages, and it'll be handy for when you go through this process. A couple of questions.
So the merge commit will still have both as a parent commit, so it keeps the old commit objects alive.
So the comment is that the parent merge, that the merge keeps both objects alive because it has both of these parents, and the answer is yes, that's exactly why you want that.
This works for third-party source code, right? I mean, not for binary architecture. If I'm getting boost, then I want the build boost for Linux, for Windows, for slides. I'm not going to build it every time. So how do you version control and manage third-party when it's not just source that you're going to build it?
So the comment is, what if you have like these binary things? So first off, if you release your library only in binary form, what kind of code is that? Asocial, right? So in this system, you build everything. You have the source code to everything, so you can modify everything, so you can contribute to everything. It'll be a long build the first time, but incrementally it's not too bad. Okay, I'm gonna move through this kind of quickly. So this is if we're going to make a modification to a third-party repository. You go over there, you make your changes, you use git GUI to commit, just like your own repositories. You commit on the normal branch. Now this is the fun part, because this is where you contribute it back to the library. So you check out the vendor branch, you update it, and then you make a new branch on your this built off of your vendor branch, just come over here, then you cherry pick your commits that you want to contribute back. You push it to your GitHub account, you log into GitHub and make a pull request. It's as simple as that. You'll get some feedback from the author that your commit sucks, you need to modify it, or it's good, we're gonna merge it right in. And then you, like on the previous screen, you update your stuff. All right, I really wanna see people making commits to third-party repositories.
Why don't you just pull the rebase?
So the question is, why don't you pull and rebase? And the reason for that you don't want to do that is because it's proper etiquette when you're doing pull requests to only have one thing that you're pull requesting. So in this case, you separate your pull requests out so that they can discuss them each individually. I'm glad you brought that up. Okay. How do we keep that vendor branch up to date always? Well, you make a cron job on your Git server to periodically update the vendor branch based on the one on GitHub or the however you get the latest version. So your vendor branch gets set equal to the originating repository's master branch or whatever's the main branch, but usually it's master. Okay? And that will always work.
Change in 12 seconds before a change. ship it, for this supposed to ship. You want to control when you, and you can set up certain other scheduling mechanisms.
So the comment is you don't want to do this because, you know, you don't want all of a sudden, you know, 2 minutes before release you get injected this new stuff. But the way that the system is set up, it's only modifying the vendor branch. Your stuff doesn't build on the vendor branch. In order to be able to use the newest one, someone has to go in there and update it to the latest of the vendor.
So does this, we develop exclusively on GitHub, I don't have a local Git appliance, so does this even work in that situation?
So the comment, does this work with GitHub? Yeah, this works the same way. So instead of having your server, you're using GitHub as your server.
So these hooks and stuff, they work, or?
So the question about the hooks. If you want to do the hooks on GitHub, then I can't answer that question. I don't know. The Boost guys do it, so presumably you can do it too.
So is this model you're using this for your releases, or is this just for your local trunk?
The question is this model for releases or for your local trunk? You can use it for both, right? So, but this, what I'm talking about is just doing this for the master branch. This is your development branch. Yeah. And it's also good etiquette, I would say, to have your master branch be stable always. Oh, was there a question?
I mean, another name for etiquette is network. I think an economist would call that network, presumably. And because of that, don't you want to use Git flow for... because Git flow has this tremendous network effect behind it. And that's what we did, you know, it's one of the few things where Boost decided, geez, here's something that has such a strong network effect, we're not gonna roll our own.
So the comment is that for the network effect, you can use Git flow and it can help out with these things. So I don't think that this is independent of that.
Right, and I'm not seeing anything that I could spot conflicting.
Yeah, so the comment, yeah, so NetFlow is another layer that you can put on top of this and use in conjunction with this that also helps out with etiquette. And I don't know very much about that, but I'm going to take your word for it and think that that's the case. All right, so let's move forward. Non-Git libraries, how do you deal with those? Because you're going to have to deal with these for now. So one way is that you can make a Git repository with a vendor branch that corresponds to dumps of releases that people make. So that's one way to do it. Submitting patches is going to be more difficult, but this can work. Another thing is to use the Git SVN tools, because a lot of these are SVN repositories, and you have your own mirror on your server which updates the vendor branch based on the SVN commits. And surprisingly enough, this works, but it is kind of a pain in the butt. But it'll work with the workflow, except for when you need to submit patches back to the maintainer. All right. So let's talk about build systems. All right. So what's the viable alternative for build systems? Batch files. Sweet. That works on every platform, this Windows.
Yes.
Well, make. A make? Okay. That works on every platform that's not Windows. CMake, I heard. That's S-cons. Yeah. Well, let's talk about CMake. It cross-compiles, it generates Visual Studio projects, it generates Ninja files, well-supported commercially. The kinks have been worked out after 16 years of use, and the vast majority of new C++ open source projects use CMake. I don't love CMake, okay? And I think you'd be hard pressed to find somebody who does, who didn't invent it. So, but it's still the only viable alternative, but it's a much more controversial thing than Git, because this question has not been adequately answered at all. Now, let's just jump right into it. So what we want to do is, getting back to the thesis here, we want to come up with a set of polite rules or etiquette for doing C++ development that will help out with those problems that we talked about at the beginning. So we need to come up with how we can use CMake properly in a way that's social and that will work with others. So your first step for your company or your individual products is write up some C++ or some CMake coding conventions, just like you do with C++. And here are some things that should go into that. What do you put at the version line at the top of every single CMake file? Do you call functions with all uppercase or all lowercase names? All lowercase names. What do you want your indentation to be? They have multiple ways to do things, like you have add definitions or target compile definitions that do very similar things. The latter is the right answer to this, but there's, if you come up with something where there's multiple ways to do it, standardize on doing it one way. When you call find package, use quiet, because it's never really useful to have CMake output which just splurges out everything that you don't need. There's also package specific conventions. So for example, if you're using find package boost, you're probably going to want to use boost all no lib as defined to always use. Otherwise, you'll have weird problems later. So there's a lot here. There's a lot more that could go here, but the idea is to make a CMake coding standards that you're using for your organization and stick with them. So here's how to do dependencies the wrong way, and this happens to be the recommended way to do it with CMake. You build each repository in isolation and generate its binaries along with the CMake config file. So for every single one of those dependencies, you make your own build of it individually. And then for each project that has dependencies, use this find package command to load in the config file for the library. And this is really unfortunate that this is the standard way to do things, because it has some really big problems. First, it's too tedious. If you have a large development with a lot of different things going on, a lot of third-party packages, you do not want to recompile each package and dependency individually. You want it to all be in one build. The second problem is the export mechanism that they recommend only works with libraries at the base of the dependency graph. So this suggestion assumes that you have all these libraries that don't depend on each other, and then you have the libraries on top of that. And that's as big as your tree goes, two layers. That doesn't work in real practice with large scale libraries. So here's what we want in a good way to handle the dependencies. One build that will build the project and all of its dependencies, not multiple builds. You want only the required dependencies to be built. So if you have something in there that isn't a dependency of something, then there's no need to build it. And then the standard find package library, so find package is the way you bring in libraries. We want these to also add the source code to the build. So if you have zlib in your repository, you don't want it to use the system version of zlib. You want it to build your version of zlib. All right, I think that's good enough there. So here's an example project of how we do this. So here we have our all, our base thing, and in it has a CMake list. Here we have two different libraries, and these go into subdirectories here. Here's another one, and these all have CMake lists. So basically every directory is gonna have a CMake list.txt, which is gonna talk about how to build the asset inside of it. Here we have the one in the CWF RF directory. Like we said, there's a minimum required here. This project thing is at the top of every file, and in your conventions, you should have it be directly related to the directory name that it comes from. Here we call find package on boost to grab in the regular expression library, because that's the standard way to do that. Then we have these two import commands, which pull in other things in your all, and I'll explain what these mean later, because this is not a built-in CMake command, although it should be. Here we make our new library. It's called CWFRF. Again, that's related to the name of the project, which is related to the name of the directory. We put our source files in there. Here we have our include directories. So first, you always do the include directory at the all level, or usually you do it at the all level, so you can include stuff in CWF/RF/whatever. And then you use boost_includers. That comes from find package. We add the compile definitions. Like I said, if you're using boost all no lib is what you want to use. Now you do your linking the libraries you want to link to, so CWF underscore base. Again, this corresponds to CWF slash base. GPC ZO corresponds to that, and the boost regex library. And then the set target properties thing, for people who love Visual Studio, this is handy. So just have a convention to where you always add this line and your Visual Studio users will be happy. If you don't care about Visual Studio, it's still nice to add it just for proper etiquette.
Sorry, what does that do, actually?
So the question is, what does this do, the set target properties thing? It makes it so in your Visual Studio project, it will organize everything in these little folders, all of your different targets, so instead of making a really gigantic list of everything.
But it will be separate projects anyway, because you have like a project blah blah at the top. So why do you need an additional folder? They will be separate projects.
Oh, the comment is that they will be separate projects anyway, and good to know.
Folders are within a project. Yeah. So within a project, within a single Visual Studio project, you can have folders. So you can put, say, all the source files in one and all the header files in another.
Yeah, so this makes a folder that's basically not necessary because it's already in its own project anyway, right?
I can talk to you after this.
But I think it's actually the other way around, because one CMake list file can generate multiple Visual Studio projects, and I think what this does is that it does a solution level folder and packs all projects into that. Because if you look at some CMake projects, when you open them in Visual Studio, you have, this is the library, here are 20 projects for the individual test executable. So that it packs up those. The problem with that is that it doesn't work with the free edition of Visual Studio.
I think that in the newest version of the free edition, that handles that properly. So the comment is that this will do it. So my Visual Studio lingo is not good. And I think this should be CWF, not CWF underscore RF. You want it to be in the CWF folder. But anyway, Visual Studio users find this helpful. So this import command, here's the poor man's import. You import this. What it really means is if this target is not already defined, you call add subdirectory. You put in the name of the directory relative to your current place. And then you put this little line to say where it's going to build based on your build directory. But you have to know the name of the target. It's kind of cumbersome to have to write that every time. But in a pinch, that's what'll work for import. What we use internally is we have a more fancy import. Here's a sketch of the implementation. We're not releasing our implementation just yet. We will later. But don't let that hold you up from using this, because this is easy to implement yourself. So you use a stack to discover dependency loops. You use global properties. That's a CMake lingo thing. You can look that up to determine if a directory has already been added, and automatically figure out the binary directory place where it's going to build it into when you call add subdirectory if it hasn't already been added. If you have that little macro made, then it makes things easier. And then you can also add import search directory to say, okay, when I import, this is basically the dash capital I of GCC for this import command. So you could do it the poor man's way, you could do it this way. Depending on how important it is to you, I would recommend implementing something like this for yourself. All right, so find package, this is interesting, because the default version of find package, which comes with CMake, was intended to be used for pre-compiled binaries, period. So that makes it quite a problem if you want to all of a sudden make find package zlib, compile zlib, and add it as a dependency to your project. So that was a flawed idea, but we can fix this. And here's how we do it. So now we have zlib in here, and zlib has a CMake list file, because the standard distribution of zlib has a CMake list file, because the standard distribution of zlib is a polite library. And we add this new subdirectory called CMake modules, and we have a find zlib.cmake. In our all CMake list file, we basically say here, that we want, when we have a find package, it'll look in this folder first before it'll use the default find package script for finding zlib. So it'll look in your own CMake modules directory first to see if it'll be in there. All right, there's a question.
Have you thought about using possibly package config instead? So when it builds the package config file, and instead of doing the find package, you just call package config to do the settings.
So the comment is, did you consider using find package or package config instead. And was that in question in response to that? Okay. And the response is that we did not find that to be viable in a way that we can make it so I get the dependency correct, so that my project depends on the zlib target as opposed to the zlib library. So the comment is, in the package config, you write out your dependencies. It still doesn't really work, and I can go into the details with that afterwards with you. We tried that. We wanted that to work really bad.
So do you put the file in the zlib file manually in the project that requires zlib?
The question is, do you put the find zlib manually in the project that requires zlib? And the answer is no. We put that in. That's something that's in all. So all is basically responsible for providing all the find package hooks. Yeah.
Okay, what I would do is that zlib provide its own find zlib and actually only put the path of the CMake module folder inside the zlib project folder. I mean, it's to avoid having multiple find zlib files.
So the comment is, you could put the find zlib thing in the zlib folder to avoid finding using multiple zlib files, and you can handle that. So if your project, which you're using, happens to provide a nice find file that you can use instead, then you can add that to your all project here in addition to your CMake modules thing, and that'll work too. But the idea is that all is responsible for providing information on how to find the other projects using this mechanism.
So I have two questions. First one, if the library like zlib already provides a CMake list, why don't you just use add subdirectory?
So the comment is, if the project already has a CMake list file, why not just add it directly to the third-party library? And the answer is because the standard way to find zlib is to use the find package command. So if I pull in a third-party library, it's not going to add subdirectory ../zlib. It's going to use find package zlib. So we want to make sure that everybody works together in the same way. You don't look satisfied with that.
I don't think I agree. Maybe we can discuss later.
Okay.
I have a slightly different answer to what you gave. We tried doing that. We found one big problem with compiler flags. They may set weird compiler flags in there, and that might not be compatible with compiler flags you want. So now you've got a big problem.
Another comment?
Just so that I understand, if I want to use your sub-project or project, not all, that depends on zlib, then I actually need to add zlib to my all CMake file list, right? In other words, I kind of need to manually satisfy all your dependencies.
So the comment is that if I use your project, I need to also get zlib and put that in my thing. So you are going to have to provide me with a zlib. You can include zlib in your all, that's one alternative, and use this mechanism, or you can just go to the default find package zlib and use the zlib that's installed on your system. So that's your choice as to how you want to set up your all. But
I still have to add it to my root CMake file list.
The comment is, but do you still have to add something to your root CMake list? And the answer is no. If you want to use the default find package zlib, you don't have to do anything. This overrides the default. So you only override the default if you want to do something other than what the default
has.
So the question is,
that you are only depending on zlib in your all CMake file, but when I'm using your package, I don't use your all. I only use the specific sub package, and there's no find zlib in the specific sub package. It's only in the all.
So the comment is that if my package uses find zlib, which is a standard CMake find thing, you are going to have to provide a zlib somehow. You have two ways of doing that. If you're on a Linux box, you can do nothing in your all, and it will use the system version of zlib. If you're on a Windows box, you're going to have to find a way to satisfy find package zlib somehow. So use binaries or put zlib in there and build it as part of this process too. So, yeah.
So the implication then is that if I use your project, I can't use a different version. I use one of my projects, they have to agree on the zlib version.
So the comment is, if you use my project, then they're going to have to agree on the zlib version. And that's not the case. It's only the case, it depends on how I use zlib, right? If I use something in the newest version, then you're going to need to upgrade. But if I use only old stuff, then it doesn't matter what version you provide, as long as I...
Right, but if you there's no way for us to use incompatible versions.
So the comment is, there's no way for us to use incompatible versions. Well, if you're using your version of zlib with my project and I'm using my version of zlib, then we're okay, actually. The problem is if you have two different projects in your all that need different versions of zlib. That's asocial. They should be using the same version for one all. All right. So here's what that find zlib looks like. If there isn't a target already in scope, add the zlib subdirectory, so that puts the zlib target in scope, and you'll recognize this is the poor man's version of import. I set zlib include directories to this. This is the zlib source directory, and this is where it builds stuff, because where it builds, it includes, one of the things that it builds is a config.h file, which zlib uses, so you want to include that as it's being built. Now we set zlib libraries, instead of setting it to the actual files that it builds, we're setting it to the target. And that actually works, strangely enough. And that's what makes this whole thing possible. We set zlib found to true, and we set the zlib version string, dot, 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 dot. But the key thing here is that you want to make sure that whatever is in your find zlib.cmake, that it's identical to what is publicly promised in the standard find zlib.cmake file. So, yeah, the customized find modules must match the semantics of the original. If you want to find out what the semantics of the original are, you do this command, cmake dash dash help dash module find zlib. And it will give you the contract of find zlib, what variables are supposed to be set. Make sure that you match that in yours. The only thing that you're doing kind of strange is you're setting the underscore libraries equal to a target as opposed to the actual libraries. Now, if you want to make your find modules work with other build systems, like whatever Qt uses, that's going to require some more work. Just like anything that's asocial, you're going to have to deal with special cases. So if you have one of these special cases, somebody uses scons or some other kind of build system, you got two options. One is you can write your own cmakelists.txt files that will build the project, presumably in another subdirectory of all, so it's not mixing with their source code. And this is actually what we do to build our boost stuff. So we have a find module, and it'll build boost using cmakelists. We plan on releasing our boost cmakelists.txt files, but really it's not that hard. You can do it yourself. Just take a look at the bjam files, and you can easily translate that into cmakelist.txt files. Or you can wrap the other build system. And this is what we do for Qt, and it's not a pretty process. It's actually kind of a crazy process. So you use globbing and construct a list of all the files that are required to build the foreign target. Okay, now you got that. Use the results of find package. So if this, like Qt, requires zlib, you call find package zlib, and then you get these variables. Use those variables to feed into the third-party library so it can build using your stuff. Then you create a custom command and custom target that executes the build. And you can just look that up on the internet on how to make custom commands and custom targets. It's kind of crazy. You make an empty library that depends on the library's dependencies, because in order to do this little trick that we do, you need to have a non-custom target. It has to be a real library target, so you make these little empty libraries. And then you use CMake's client requirements feature. Just Google that to make users of the custom target link to the libraries that are generated by the other thing. It's a pain in the butt. But my hope is that we can stop having asocial libraries so we don't have to do this. But for now, you can work with it. You can wrap other build systems. It just is going to require time.
So Qt provides CMake files. So I'd say that's actually quite social.
returns. I've never had problems with just downloading Qt from their homepage and then pointing to their CMake files. And that always worked for me.
So the comment is that Qt provides CMake files. And my response to that is, woohoo, that's great. Because we're using an older version. We're still in the 4 series, so we don't get CMake files. But that is great news because so Qt is getting more social. They're getting more polite in what they're releasing. That's really great news. All right, so now we have selectively enabling projects. So if you have your all and you have a dozen projects in there, you don't want to build them all the time. I just want to check this one and this one. Here's how to do this. And the benefits of this is you get a quicker build and dependency checking. CMake doesn't have a way to do that, but we can make that happen. And your all cmakelist.txt file, you just glob in each one of these source directories that you have, each one of your repositories, and look for a project.cmake file. If there is one, you include it. Okay, so now what's in that project.cmake file? It enables a new option to the build that defaults to false. And if it's true, then you just import that. So that means that when you configure your project, you configure it, and then you can check which projects you want to build, and it'll build only those projects and their dependencies. And that's it. So here are some takeaways from CMake. Enforcement of strict conventions is very important. It's easy to get a CMake code base in a large project to get out of control. You got to be tough with it, especially if you're new with it, because it looks like a crazy hairy language, and it kind of is. So you really need to make sure you enforce these strict conventions. And the other takeaway is that it really does the job. And if you do it carefully, it can do it really nice. So I highly recommend it. You know, I just kind of like this picture. I don't really have any comments to put out there. So from Stellar Science, here are some results. We have this system in use now with over 40 developers on dozens of projects. Contributions to open source are frequent now because it's all very social. It's very easy to contribute to open source projects. We have multi-platform development and multi-platform deployment. And this is the rule more than the exception for us. We got people who love Visual Studio. Well, they can use Visual Studio. We got people who love using Linux, and they can use Linux. And by the way, if you're building on Linux, make sure you use Ninja as your generator, as opposed to Make. It's about 10 times faster every time that I've run the test. And that makes a big difference if it's like 30 seconds to 3 seconds for dependency checking. All right. So CMake and Git, mind your manners. That's the end of the talk. So if you have any questions, now's the time. So the question is, how easy is it to customize CMake for strangey-dangy compilers? Does anybody comment on that?
Yeah, there are a couple of ways to do it. We create a bunch of CMake modules. The first one we call is the dev platform, which gives a lot of information about the particular platform. Then it interrogates the compilers to make sure that we know exactly what that compiler is. And then we have a set of flags that we'll set for.
So CMake will call your module, and then you would generate the command line and pass that off to get formed.
Set all the flags.
So the comment was basically saying using modules as a way to, as a means to achieve that goal. Is I haven't done that personally myself, but I think that it can be done.
I've done CMake has two chains that you can control, but everything for any cross platform in the very strange things for compilers and things.
One particular example is include paths. One compiler, I have to include paths within parentheses. It's not just changing the flag that goes to it. I need to have an open parenthesis, unique flags for each of the include paths, and then a closed parenthesis at the end of.
So some more discussion about cross compilation.
I'm intrigued by and agree after listening to you with your with the notion of flattening the submodule nest. Say I'm like, you know, I do graphics and stuff, and I have a friend who has his own Git repo who does I/O and networking and stuff like that. And we're going to collaborate loosely, but we want to share our files on the Git. So we do want to have a common project. Just how would you recommend orchestrating that? Like, I do need to submodule my stuff and his stuff into something that we then both. So
the comment is, if you're collaborating deeply with somebody and you each have your own separate repositories, I think that that situation would be to create an all super product that you guys both use. Yeah.
My experience in many organizations is that process force appealed by fiat never works. There has to be a tool. I mean, you were saying, oh, here's a big long list of Git commands, which are like, some of which I don't understand. Follow these, I guarantee it will work in most places.
So the comment is, you can't have a list of rules because people won't follow them. That's what code reviews are for. If you want your code to actually get into master, then it needs to pass review. I think that's the...
It's not so much code review as, you know, here's a tool, you have to follow this process, and here's a big document about what you're meant to follow. I've found in most cases where you have documents like that, and I've been in many places where we've tried to do it in similar ways, it's very, very hard to get people to follow those rules and do it accurately. You need a tool to do that process for you. For most developers, it's like, yeah, give me a button to click and do it.
So the comment is basically a big preference for tools to be used instead of convention.
Yeah.
And I think that... That's everybody's desire, but in this case, convention can work. So this works in our organization and it works in others. Maybe we just have different setups, but that's the best we got. Yeah.
In my experience, the most horrendous CMake files I've seen, I've not gone through and proven it, but I strongly suspect what caused the complexity was a cyclical dependency that somebody didn't understand, and rather than fix the code, they figured out some hack to the build system to make it work.
So the comment was that in the worst CMake incident that they've seen is something where a circular dependency was there and nobody realized it, and they used the build system to work around it. Yeah, that kind of stuff is terrible. That's why you need to have like really strict rules on how to proceed. Or at least that's what works for us. So I'll go around the room this way.
When you have your CMake list for boost, do you guys build boost contents as well?
The comment is, with our CMake list.txt for boost, do we build boost context as well? Do we build that? I don't know if we build that one.
I'm not sure. Did you do them all or just do them as you needed?
We just build components of them, basically.
Yeah. All right, so next.
So if your repo 2, for example, depends on CLIT, where do you specify that dependency? In the old project, or?
So if I have a project which depends on zlib, where do I specify that dependency?
Yeah.
And that would be in its CMake list.txt file. That find underscore package is the declaration of the dependency.
So that would be like in repo 2 CMake list?
That would be what?
In the repo 2, like you had these names, repo 1, repo 2, repo 3.
Yes. Yeah,
not
so that would, right, so it's not inside the all, it's in the individual repository which depends on
it. So each of your individual submodules or repositories, they are able to compile individually.
So the comment is, can each of these compile individually? And the answer is yes, as long as they have an all which provides them with zlib and whatever they might need. Yeah.
What do you mean as long as they have an all? I thought there's only one all, that's like...
Right, there's only one all.
As long as they share an all. Okay, so if somebody only checks out like one of your submodules, one of your libraries,
mm-hmm.
does that compile?
So the question is, if they only check out one of my libraries, does that compile? It will compile as long as all of its dependencies are provided for.
Where?
If it has no dependencies, then it will compile by itself.
Okay, so but in the case of CLIB, which he wouldn't check out in that case because that only gets checked out when he checks out all, right? So it wouldn't compile.
So in the case of zlib, the assertion is that it wouldn't compile. It depends on what platform you're on. If you're on Windows,
okay. Yeah.
It won't.
Yeah.
If you're on Linux, it will.
But that basically, in the beginning you said you don't expose all repositories to the public, right? So that kind of goes a bit against that, right? So you need to expose your all project.
So what comes is that you need to expose your all project, and I'm not so sure that you do. Because the dependencies, to find out what dependencies your subproject has, you look in its CMake list file, and then you see that, okay, I need to get this, I need to get this, I need to get this. And then that will be the indication that someone needs to manually get those individually. And again, that just kind of brings out the need for the dependency manager. There was another one over here. Nope, circling back around again.
Well, this comes back full circle to my first question. I'm still not getting what the utility of and the necessity of the all project is. If I have in my project X, Zlib, and you're telling me that it can find it wherever without the all project, then from what your discussion here, the only utility I saw mentioned was it helping execute the find. I have to say I'm still totally mystified as to what the utility of the all project is.
Okay, there's not an understanding as to what the utility of the all project is. So to sum it up, I would say it provides whatever's in that CMake list file that we have in the all project, whatever benefits it provides. So if a project requires Zlib, it'll tell it how to find it. It's a way to contain all of these different submodules in one spot.
So it would be necessary if I have a subproject that requires Zlib, then I would have to have an all project that had some reference to Zlib in it.
So the comment is that if I have a project which requires Zlib, then I would have to have an all which has a Zlib in it if I want to build. And that's true on Windows and not true on Linux. Sorry.
No, okay, that's fine. So we need the all project in order to reconcile or to resolve dependencies. Without that, we wouldn't be able to do it across projects. Is that a fair statement?
So the comment is that we need all in order to resolve dependencies between the projects, and I think that's true. Okay.
How good of dependency detection does CMake do, and does it maintain those as your code evolves and you put new includes or include files in many levels deep change?
So the question is, how good is CMake's dependency checking? And the answer is perfect as far as I know. I haven't seen it miss a dependency. Sometimes it depends on how you set up your CMake list file to list the source files. If you have a glob in there and just say, oh, my source includes all these CPP files in this directory and all the H files in this directory, if you add a CPP file, it's not automatically going to know that that has been added. So I don't like globbing personally. I like it to be explicitly added, which means if you go with that route, then you can be sure that if you add a new CPP file, then it will regenerate your project.
What about header files? If I add a new header file inside of a CPP file, do I then have to update a CMake file in order to explicitly point out that new dependency?
So the question was, if I add a new include in a CPP file, does that mean that I need to modify my CMake code or do something in order for the dependency to work? And the answer is no. So that gets handled well. Yes. Yes. It does the right thing there.
So to comment on the previous question, I think it's only true if you want to build the libraries from source in Windows, for example. So if there is a binary of the library, then you're fine again. You can just provide the path to the binary to CMake, and then you're fine.
I'm not sure I really understood that, but let's go to this question.
I think like he asked, like, do we need the all?
You're going back to that question.
I was just thinking about cross-product dependencies. I was looking for the case, what the all is really necessary for. If we miss it, where are we going to notice? My understanding is that if I have project A, it depends on project B.
Yeah.
Without something in the all, we're not going to make the bridge. That's what I understood.
Yeah.
And it doesn't sound right to me, but that's what I understood.
So the thing is that if you're on Linux, so your project A, which depends on Zlib, if you're on Linux, project A, in project A you have a find package Zlib, and it will find the clip in your system distribution. So you're basically fine. But if you're, let's say, on Windows and you have to build clip from source, then you need the all project, because only the all project will include both project A and C.
And I think that's the way I understood it. If you have a cross-product dependency, you have to have something in the all to register that dependency. That's the way I'm hearing this.
Only if it's not installed in the system.
Yeah, right. I'm aware of that, which is the normal case. I'm saying a cross-project dependency, that one project has to be built in order for another project to be built. That won't work unless something is installed. That's what I've understood here.
Okay. So maybe we can talk afterwards, because I'm not sure you understand that, because the dependency information is not in all.
Yeah.
All just kind of says, it just kind of coordinates.
Well, and that's exactly what the subject of my skepticism is. Project A should register the fact that it depends on Project B.
So it does.
What does the all guys do?
So it does do that, but let's talk afterwards, and I'll explain that in more detail. So there was a question over here.
I guess I'm having the same problem that he is that if you're listing your dependencies in the all, right, and one of the slides you had was a continuous integration picture, then how do you, your project has to be able to build by itself. It doesn't sound like that happens. So I'm wondering how, if you have continuous integration, implementing your system, how are you meeting that?
So, this all will work for every single person's all, right? If you add more projects, you don't have to add more things to all here. This is complete. All the projects say what they depend on. All just kind of says that if you happen to be using find package, you can, I will provide you with information about that.
So,
and
where is the find package? Is that in all CMake or is that in the project CMake?
It's in the project CMake.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the all does not list dependencies. It's every a project CMake make list lists dependencies. All just tells it where to find them.
But that's what I was expecting, but the way I inferred it was that it was every all the dependencies are listed in the all. And then, it's going to pull down those dependencies, and each project has a dependency on that zlib or whatever. It works just because the all pulled it down.
So the comment is, let me just skip the comment and just go to the answer, which is, all does not list dependencies. Every individual project lists dependencies. I'm not calling on you. Go ahead.
So, I really like what you presented. I think it's awesome. But I think this is exactly like maybe the only the one flaw of your system. It's that on some systems, your individual projects will compile, basically as long as find package works, and on other system, Windows, it won't compile.
So
I think that's a really big flaw, actually, of the system.
So the comment...
It does work, but not so well, and you often need to provide it with hints where to find stuff and find the binaries. Binaries, if possible.
So,
source.
All right. So we got some more questions over here.
I'm also very impressed. I'm very interested. Actually, we see it like a lot. We have this issue. I'm also a little bit confused. I find it would be very helpful if you get a more worked example, like a real world example. Here's whatever library, I can't remember what the library is you produce. You guys write a library, right? Your company.
Yeah, a ton.
You don't have to give all the details of code, but you could describe, well, here's in practice how it works for us with all of our dependencies. Because I must admit, I'm a bit confused as well exactly how it works.
Okay, so the request was that we go through how it works in our system. We got 5 minutes left.
I didn't mean now, maybe at some point in the future.
At some point in the future, I really hope that this is the last talk I give on CMake and Git. All right, green shirt.
I just wanted to clarify that find package is so terrible in Windows because there's no common place to place your libraries when you're installing them. So you don't really, you have to have like custom write your CMake module if you really want to find something on Windows.
So
easy to implement.
The comment was that it's really hard to use find package on Windows. This solves that, right? Because you put your customized find modules in your CMake modules, and those build those packages. I really don't want to be using binaries. That's asocial.
But it works pretty well, again, if you provide it with a path to the binary and populate your CMake cache with that path, then it works pretty well. So basically, you need to provide like an initial cache file, and when you run CMake, you need to run dash C, and then, and I think that's basically even a good solution, because it means like you have one file where you have all the paths to your libraries, like a path to the boost binaries, to OpenCV binaries, whatever, and it's like you have only this one file with your path, and then the find packet scripts, even on Windows, will be able to find all the libraries. That's how I do it.
Okay, I'm gonna go with Beeman and then Robert.
I just wanted to make a suggestion that you might want to look very closely at how Git flow went viral. Look at that initial blog posting, because if my understanding of the history is right, he wrote one blog posting, and that was it. From that, and he never had to do it again. You know, he was asked to come and give talks and things like that later, but he managed in one blog posting to convey enough information to cause vast numbers of people to essentially create social, to create an edifice.
So the comment was that, what's the name of that again?
Git
flow. That pretty much took the world by storm with just one blog post. That'd be worth checking out.
I think I've got this figured out now. You've got like 15 seconds. The dependencies are within the modules, and the problem is that the find statement doesn't work out of the box. So in the alt project, we have the little helper that helps the find statement work and find out what other module fulfills the dependency we've listed. And I think that's the answer I was looking for. I don't know if it's correct, but I think that's...
You nailed it. All right.
I have one last question. Actually, a possible solution to the fact that a library will not compile Windows because we don't have the submodule inside the library. What if we actually have the old project, but the library itself also has the required dependencies as its own submodules? And if we are not getting the library from the old project, it will actually use its own submodules. Otherwise, we'll get the stuff from the old project. That's how I do it. It's not very elegant, but it works.
So the comment is that if it doesn't provide it in...
The priority is in the old project. If there is no old project, go check out my own submodule.
So the comment is that if all project doesn't provide it, then look in your own submodules and have it, and I would argue that's asocial. We don't want to go there because of all the problems that I mentioned before. All
right. So what do you think about the add external dependencies command for third-party libraries?
So the comment, the question is, what about the add external dependencies command? I'm not really familiar with that one, so I can't comment on it very well. All right, so I think that's it.